Joseph Barroso joins us now. Welcome to Bloomberg, and thank you so much for giving us a little bit of your busy schedule. First of all, Mr. Barroso, when you look at everything that's going on, the recovery, but also the need for vaccines, vaccine distribution, not only in developed countries, what are we getting right and what are we getting wrong?
I mean, first of all, I think we have to learn the lessons of this pandemic. It's true that there was great progress in vaccines, record, so we could develop vaccines in a record time, but there are problems in terms of distribution and delivery, and there are inequalities also. And the point we have been saying is that we need a stronger commitment to rapid vaccine delivery all over the world, because it's not just a slogan. No one is safe until everyone is safe. Why we say that? Because while the virus is circulating, there are more possibilities of new variants, possibly more transmissible and more dangerous. And we are seeing that, in fact. So at the same time that there has been very successful rollout in some parts of the world, namely in the UK, in the United States, also Europe now is catching up, and other parts of the world, the reality is that there are other, low-income mm-hmm. countries that are much, much, much behind. So we need to speed up that effort. But besides that, besides this most immediate priority, because the pandemic is not over, far from that, we need to think globally about what we are going to do in the future. And what we are proposing, this Resilience Commission, is that we look at the issue of health and economic resilience as seriously as we have been looking after the financial crisis of 2008 and the following years to financial sustainability and stability, and also as we are looking to climate change. And in fact, those issues are linked. So health, economics, and environment are linked. And what we are proposing, based on a study of a very, very, let's say, great scientists from a great network all over the world, is for the G7 and then the G20 to take the leadership in this and to make this a kind of a Bretton Woods moment where we can look holistically in a much more determined and structured way to the issues of health resilience.
But Mr. Barroso, do you see that countries and leaders are willing to do so? Are we at a moment where actually there's a lot of commonplace for leaders to come together, or is it still each for their own? I mean, we're seeing even with taxes now, the UK wants financial services to be exempt from this 50% global tax. What does that mean in practice?
Look, in general terms, I see some progress. Like this last week, I had the honor together with the Prime Minister of Japan to host a pledging conference for COVAX, for the global facility to distribute vaccines. And in fact, we exceeded our objectives. So we have seen also great cases of generosity. But more has to be done in terms of commitment. For instance, in terms of dose sharing, countries that have surplus doses, we have to share some of those doses. If not, of course, we'll have huge differences that can only become more serious. So we see some progress, and we believe that the leaders of G7, the wealthiest countries in the world, now have to do more. We hope, in fact, to have some progress in this G7 summit. We saw also some announcements made, not only in terms of financial commitments, but also in terms of solidarity to the developing world, to low-income countries. Mm-hmm. And we believe this is a way forward. And also, by the way, the OECD should be part of it through also some of these measures that we are proposing. So, yes, there is some progress, but to be honest, Francine, not so much as we'd like to see. We need more urgency.
Okay. In what kind of field? So specifically, what do we need to work on? We keep on hearing from leaders that they're rebuilding better, but actually, what is the actionable thing that they can do in the next 2 months to make a real difference?
First of all, increase the pace of vaccination. And I've told you how we can do it, by sharing doses globally. Of course, the pharmaceutical companies, they are ramping up production to have more funds for those who don't have the means to buy those vaccines. This is a very concrete thing. To go as far as possible. We believe now it will be possible by the end of the year, beginning of next year, to have at least 1.8 billion of vaccines distributed to low-income countries. That's what we are doing. And that has been progress. This is the first thing. But beyond that, we have to recognize one thing. The world was not prepared for this pandemic, including the richest and the most powerful countries in the world. They were not prepared. There were not mechanisms of adequate surveillance, sharing of data. There was not, in fact, even some protocols of cooperation. So we need to invest more. There was a need. The investment on health resilience was neglected for many years. And what we are saying is that we should consider this matter of health resilience at least as important as financial stability or climate change. And these matters are connected. That's why we are proposing the leaders to have a kind of a Bretton Woods moment to reinforce the global mechanisms, for instance, with increased transparency in terms of pandemic preparedness, but also further investment in global health, because health is very much linked, of course, as we are seeing, to economics.
Mr. Barroso, so going back to what Rishi Sunak seems to want to propose, which is that financial services and finance companies be exempt from this 15% global tax, do you agree with that? Is that the good strategy for banks based in London?
I'm sorry, I have not yet seen that proposal. I'm not in a position to comment. I believe the global effort to have a minimum tax that is being promoted now makes sense. And I think there is progress made by the G7 at the level of finance ministers, and most likely we'll see that now ratified by the heads of state and heads of government meeting this weekend in UK. That is progress, and the OECD is working on that, and we hope that the G20 will approve that as well. Now, about that specific proposal, I'm so sorry, but I have not yet seen it. I cannot comment on that.
No, it is absolutely fresh and new, so of course I respect that. Mr. Barroso, when you look at some of the tensions between the UK and the EU because of Brexit, again, what's the right way forward? What does it mean for financial services? Do we just need some kind of agreement on the protocol that the EU need to back down to make sure that actually we're on a much steadier path and more of a friendship between the two?
There has been some friction, unfortunately. I believe it's unfortunate to have this friction, but in a way it was almost unavoidable. I mean, when there is a separation after so many years, it's like in a couple, there is some trauma. And we are still in this post-traumatic moment in the relations between the UK and the European Union. And I hope now there will be more constructive talks. There are issues that have to be addressed. The issue of Northern Ireland is a very complex issue. I believe in financial services. If you want my sincere opinion, and I'm speaking completely independent, I'm no longer president of the European Commission. I remain a very committed European. I believe that there will be divergence. I think now it's quite clear that the United Kingdom wants to go its own way. It has its right to take also some, let's say, benefits from some, let's say, specificity of its financial regulation, which does not mean, by the way, I don't think it means that they are going to lower the standards. I know well the British regulators, they are extremely strict. They are not going to lower the standards, but in fact, they are deciding to go their own way. And also the European Union that accepted the free trade agreement in terms of no tariffs, no quotas for goods, has not completed a financial services agreement in the United Kingdom and will not complete. There will probably be a memorandum of understanding in some global principles, yes, but I do not believe there will be some kind of passporting or the rule of equivalence. So we are going to see some divergence in terms of the global approach to financial services in Europe, in the euro area, but also in the European Union as a whole and in the United Kingdom.
So how do you see London actually faring as a financial centre given all of this?
London is one of the two biggest financial places in the world, and I believe it will continue to be because it has a great tradition, great know-how. It's a hub, a cluster, not only of very important financial institutions, but legal, audit companies. I mean, there is a real cluster of strengths here in London. At the same time, we are seeing also that the European regulators are making it clear that they want that those who are operating, namely in the euro area, and the European regulators, everybody around the European Central Bank and European Central Bank, making clear that they want also those capabilities to go to Europe. So in Europe, there will not be just one center. It's from Paris to Frankfurt to Milan to Amsterdam to other places. So there will be, I think the international banks are going to increase their footprint in Europe. But London will certainly remain a very important and global major hub for financial services.